that in the biblical usage of the word brethren, it is often used to refer to people of the same tribe or of the same family. That's quite correct. But it is also true that the term brethren, that's my second point, has been used also in the Bible to refer to the close kins of the descendants of Isaac or the Israelites. We find evidence for that in the book of Genesis, chapter 16, verse 12, and chapter 25, verse 18. And since Moses was already addressing the Israelites in his presence, and he says, God will send you from among your brethren, this seemed to be an obvious reference to the closest branch to the Israelites, i.e., the Ishmaelites. The third point is that while it could be argued that Prophet Jesus, peace be upon him, is similar to Moses in a sense that they both are Israelites, both came to help or save their people, you could make analogies like that, which is not only applicable between Moses and Jesus, but also between Moses and any other Israelite prophet for that. There have been several Israelite prophets who could possibly fall in that description. But if we look carefully about the crucial similarities and differences between Moses and Muhammad on one hand, and Jesus and Muhammad, peace be upon them all, on the other hand, we find that it's quite interesting. But for the sake of time, I'll just touch a few of them. In my humble little booklet, which is called Muhammad in the Bible, there is a table there that provides 10 areas of comparison, which includes natural birth for the first two, and by that I mean Moses and Muhammad, which is different in the case of Jesus. Natural death or end of the mission of the first two, but not in the case of Jesus, peace be upon him. But very important differences here, which shows the close similarity, is that Prophet Moses and Muhammad, peace be upon them, brought a complete code of law. Whereas Jesus himself said, I came not to destroy the law or prophets, I came to fulfill. And any objective examination of his teaching shows that he focused largely on the spiritual element that was badly needed by the Israelites, who already had a complete code of law already since the time of Moses. But only Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, who came after Moses, came with a complete code of law, and that's a significant area of similarity. He is really like unto Moses. Second, Prophet Moses was both a prophet and a statesman and a head of a community, a person who encountered his enemies in hot pursuits and was victorious. So was the case of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, but that comparison doesn't apply to Prophet Jesus, peace be upon him. You could go on and on, but I just add one more point, that Prophet Moses and Muhammad both were seen by their followers as simply human beings, not divine beings. That is not the case with the followers of Prophet Jesus, peace be upon him. That leads us then to conclude that the only logical prophet who is really like unto Moses in many respects is not Jesus, as Paul misinterpreted in some of his writings, but rather it was Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. In the same book, we move to the third prophecy of eight. In the same book of Deuteronomy, now in chapter 33, in the very beginning, we have something very interesting and very curious, for it also seemed to connect Moses, Jesus, and Muhammad, peace be upon them. And basically, Moses is making that statement shortly before his death. He says, God came from Sinai, rose up unto them from the hills of Seir, and shined forth from Mount Paran. He added also, a fiery law went out of his right hand, and he added also later, with him came 10,000 of saints. Before we try to analyze this and see whether it has any relevance to the connection between the Abrahamic religions, I'd like to draw your kind attention to the phraseology in the Bible, which to me looks like stages of the sun rising. The sun rises, then it gets somehow at duha time, but then shines forth in the noon hour, and there could be no more shining after noon hour, there could be decline. So that means some sort of progression in the extent or degree of light and guidance. Now when it says God came from Sinai, of course, Muslims and Jews as well, and Christians for that matter, believe that God is not physical. Of course, the idea of incarnation is different, but the notion that is even accepted by all three religions that God is not physical is not limited. So obviously the reference here is coming to the command of God, coming of the revelation of God, or help of God, not physical. God coming from Sinai then, or his revelation coming, is an obvious reference to Moses receiving the Torah on Mount Sinai. That's God came. Rose up, first God, rose up unto them, more light, more guidance, more revelation from the hills of Seir. Those of you who are familiar with the geography of Palestine know that there is a village which is called Sa'ir. Village called Sa'ir. And actually, the name is not new. You go back even to the time of Al-Yaquti al-Baghdadi, in which he says Sa'ir also is a village in Palestine. And that could be a possible reference to the coming of Prophet Jesus, peace be upon him. But then what is Paran or Faran? You might recall that we said earlier that Al-Yaquti al-Baghdadi stated quite clearly that Faran in Arabic, which is the equivalent of Paran, is actually Hijaz, and more specifically Mecca. And that has been the old tradition how the name was given. And it is exceedingly interesting also to notice or remind ourselves that in Genesis chapter 21, verse 21, it specifically and clearly states that Hagar and Ishmael dwelt in the wilderness of Paran, Mecca. This is something which is indisputable. In fact, we all know that there are relics already existing in Mecca confirming the tradition that has been there among the Arabs, traditional, historical traditions, that they are descendants of Ishmael. We know that the Kaaba was built by Prophet Abraham with the help of his son Ishmael. We know that it is believed that Hagar is buried next to the Kaaba. That's why it's called Hajj Hajar. You don't make tawaf inside, you have to go outside of that. We know that the well of Zamzam was the well that gushed with water under the feet of baby Ishmael while crying out of thirst when he was left with his mother by his father, Abraham. So in that sense, the pieces seem to fit together. But then there are two additional things in that prophecy that seem to confirm this and show that this is not a forced interpretation. Because it says from his right hand went a fiery law for him. There was no prophet who was sent with a complete code of law after Moses but one, Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. But something very fascinating. When it speaks about the 10,000 of saints, and if we remember, the number of Muslims who went with the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam victoriously back to Mecca